for me to do. I'm living on. Dog food composes my wife on D. That's right. Dog food. Dog food. Dog food.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. He's not taking off his clothes tonight, girls. I didn't get a chance to really give you the full introduction because you were playing there, but I read that you described your music as being savage. Is that what you think it is, or is that a misquote?
Well, no, I was talking to your chick who works for you the other day.
Yeah.
Is this mic working?
Yep.
Yeah, and she asked me for a one-word definition.
Yep.
And one hates to define oneself, you know, so I just used what some guy in a newspaper said that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, you got more than... I know you're
since
out of breath.
Since then, I've come up with painful... it's intrusive music.
Okay.
But only intrusive to squares. It's for fun.
May I say, it's easily heard.
I thought so.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. But can I ask you something that I've always wanted to ask people who do what you do for a living? Because your music is loud and it's driving, do you hear yourself, can you hear your own voice when you're singing back there?
Oh yeah, absolutely. We have, well, actually you paid for it, but we have these little monitors.
Yeah?
I'll tell you what.
Yeah?
No, sorry. Oh, really? It's a good question. When
that band is
when
driving.
When you see the next song, you'll notice on the left and right of the stage, to the far side, these little boxes on the floor.
Got it.
That's half of it. And then you've got great ones, these little things on stands, little tiny speakers pointing toward either of the guitar people.
Players, persons. Yeah.
They're right.
Yeah.
And that's how you hear each other.
Okay.
You know, it's sort of a very, it's the musician's bane. It's the bane of your existence, because when you start out, you can't hear...
Nothing.
You can't hear...
Anything.
You can't hear what I can't flush in my hotel all the time.
They got the signs in the hotels too, huh?
Well, no, it's just that, you know, I live in a cheap place. You know?
But how big an audience for this type of music, which has been called new wave, do you think there is? And if you toned it down a little bit, maybe you'd have more fans. Do you think about that at all? Why are you bleeding? Why are you bleeding?
Oh, because I'm on your show.
Oh, okay.
No, I hit.
Do
my,
you do that?
I hit my nose. No, I'll tell you, I hit my nose in the mic stand because I was determined not to break one of your mics.
Do you? This thing where you throw up on the audience and make yourself bleed and roll
is
on glass.
Water? Here we go. Sorry.
Do you do that?
What? Did I ever?
Yeah.
Yes.
Why?
Well.
See how quiet they are. They want to hear.
The first time I ever did it was out of frustration. I just felt very bad at the time, and music is an expressive medium that sometimes it can get out of hand, you know, and suddenly maybe you'll be playing a tune, and you really want to express the truth,
And the truth at that moment was that I ought to be cut. So I cut myself, mm-hmm. You know?
You see, that scares some people.
Well, that was a long time ago,
okay.
Man.
Okay, now.
I know, what were you doing that year, you know?
I don't know.
73.
What year did you do it?
73, I think you were covering, you were just starting to cover really interesting news events for a LA show,
that's
is that right?
That's correct.
About that year, you know, so you know.
Why shouldn't people be frightened by this music?
Well, I didn't, you know, that's not,
you know, like
not,
you said
that's not nothing to do with the music, that's just something I did once. You
okay,
know?
But there are some people who, as
I had problems, I hope to hell that somebody in the record business and the movie business, you know, who wants to watch someone with some real talent and something and say, well, forgive me for my problems formerly, you know? You know, out there, you know? If people don't forgive you for your problems, what, you know?
Just as some people were very terrified of rock and roll when it started, and then they got terrified of the Beatles, there are some people who get scared by any new trend in music.
Fair enough. I'll tell you one terror. Good question.
Okay.
In this music. One terror is that if you play music like the way I do, okay, obviously already, if I put as much into a song as I possibly can on your show, automatically for 5-10 minutes, it's very hard for me to speak articulately or to talk to you. You see, because
you're pumped
because
up
I've,
back there,
because
sure.
I've quite given myself totally to that. It's Dionysic. If you know the difference between Dionysic and Apollonian art.
I'm not too good on that.
Dionysic art in Greek times was where like a bunch of people would get together and they'd erect a paper phallus 50 feet long and carry it around and chant to some god that they believed in, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and sort of, how should I say, the creation of an event. It's eventful art.
Mm-hmm.
Apollonian is when you just make a statue and it's there forever and it's set out very clearly.
Okay.
There's a Dionysic element to my art that does, I suppose a lot of people might be frightened to be me, but I'm quite happy to be, you know?
All right. In the world of music, who are your favorites? Who are people you've looked up to as you've grown up and grown into the music business?
A lot of otherworldly types, like Sun Ra is one. A guy called Cab Calloway,
mm-hmm.
you probably know him.
Mm-hmm.
What's the guy? Fats Waller.
Okay.
Howlin' Wolf.
People that you're talking about could be described in a one-word label again as being conventional.
No, they weren't at the time.
But everything evolves, you know, when you look back.
Well, they got conventional this year, but back then they were sort of sleazy, you know. I mean, I hang out, you know. I mean, I'd rather have fun than anything else, you know.
But you said something at the beginning of our talk. This music is supposed to be fun.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It's not a put down, it's not a threat, it's
It's for fun.
Okay.
That's what it's for. It's a function like.
Will you introduce the gentleman in your band when you get back to do this next number?
I'd love to, terrific.
All right, you do that. And the song that you're going to sing for us is called 5'1".
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. Iggy Pop will be right back after these announcements from our sponsors and from the NBC television stations. And thank you for being with us tonight. Okay. Here again are Iggy Pop and the band, and the song is called 5'1". But first, some introductions, Iggy, if you please.
Okay, yeah. Hi, America. This is Iggy Pop talking, and that's Rob Dupre there. He plays the guitar. And this guy's Michael Page. He plays the bass guitar. This guy here is Dougie Baum. He plays the drums. And that's Ivan Kral, and he plays the guitar too.
This is Iggy Pop.
All right, let's go. Just be natural.
Now you watch this, man. Looking up in the city. What the hell? What the heck? I stare at the concrete, the curtains rise high. Steel's above me, love's in my eyes. Still I'm doing the things a 5-1 man can do. I'm only 5-1 man. I got a pain in my heart. All night I'm working in your amusement park. A bottle of aspirin, a sack full of jokes. I wish I could go home with all you big folks. I wish life could be Swedish magazines. 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 I'm only 5-1. Has come. I won't grow anymore. Anymore, anymore, no, anymore. I'm using my head, checking it twice. Wanna find out who's naughty and nice. And I'm doing the things a 5-1 man can do.
Yes, I love her so. Do you see?